Macmillan Audio presents Dirtbag, written and read by Amber Alee Frost. For the first word I ever spoke, the first word I ever wrote, Mom. Introduction. Men make their own history, but they do not make it as they please. They do not make it under self-selected circumstances, but under circumstances existing already, given and transmitted from the past. The tradition of all dead generations weighs like a nightmare on the brains of the living, and just as they seem to be occupied with revolutionizing themselves and things, creating something that did not exist before, precisely in such epochs of revolutionary crisis, they anxiously conjure up the spirits of the past to their service, borrowing from them names, battle slogans, and costumes in order to present this new scene in world history in time-honored disguise and borrowed language. Karl Marx, the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. If she says she can do it, she can do it. She don't make false claims. David Bowie, Queen Bitch. Call me Amber. I know opening my self-important little book of essays with a nod to a masterpiece is brass neck, pretentious, try-hard, self-indulgent, cringe, etc. But aren't we all sometimes? And anyway, all those pretty little horses bolted the moment I signed a book contract for a memoir. So I'm having fun with it, and I encourage you to do the same whenever possible. I want this book to be informative and useful, but I also want it to be entertaining, well-written, and a pleasurable read, not an obligation. My story is easy enough to ignore. I'm not standing on your front lawn blasting the audiobook through a boombox. No one is making you read it, I hope. Least of all me. And if someone voluntarily slogs through an entire book they don't like or don't care about, that's on them. So if you're listening to this, I have to at least assume it's because you want to know what I saw and what I have to say about it. My credentials were often acquired by happenstance, right place, right time. I started out in Indiana working on Planned Parenthood and anti-Tea Party activism, and I started a chapter of a then-obscure organization, now fairly well-known as Democratic Socialists of America. From there, I moved to New York. I was on the ground for Occupy Wall Street, and I worked for the Working Families Party before being hired as one of DSA's four employees at the time. I wrote about arts and culture, and eventually left politics in Jacobin and other outlets, before jumping into the first Bernie campaign and taking a job co-hosting the podcast Chapo Trap House with Will Meneker, Matt Chrisman, Felix Biederman, and Virgil Texas, just in time for the second Bernie campaign. Not a bad resume when you're trying to justify to others or yourself writing a book about socialism in the here and now. Unfortunately, I frequently take on too many labor-intensive projects at once, which often leads to panic, guilt, and eventually a state of obsessive work ethic-induced self-loathing so severe that I eventually just go catatonic and stare at a wall for a week. It's a similar irony to opening a food delivery app, seeing 600 options, and becoming so overwhelmed that you lose your appetite. This was difficult to start writing and even more difficult to finish. So in preparation for this book of essays on my experiences with socialist politics before and after the two campaigns of Bernie Sanders, I decided to get a shrink. But not just any shrink. I sought and acquired a shrink who specializes in a technique called cognitive behavioral therapy, a hypermanagerial approach to mental health based on eliminating negative thoughts and behavior patterns and supplanting them with healthier ones. The idea is that the subject can create new habits to live a more functional and productive life, regardless of any underlying suffering, which they are now better able to endure with stoic resilience thanks to CBT. It's not that the approach actually discourages the subject from looking inward, but it allows her to function without looking too deeply. This was ideal for me, lest the void gaze back and it became a whole thing where I might have to put real work on hold in order to work on myself, which is what I came to CBT to avoid doing in the first place. I call it psychoanalysis for Protestants, and it may not be as healthy as a deep dive, but it's way less of a hassle. My therapist was a right-wing Orthodox Jew who openly abhorred Bernie Sanders. He was exactly what I needed. I never actually asked him whether he Googled me and found my writing or my podcast, but at some point I had to assume. He never mentioned the election per se, but he had a tendency to suddenly and without provocation speak glowingly of people like Dennis Prager, the virulently anti-communist Jewish talk show radio host who went from never Trump conservative to the Donald's biggest cheerleader. My shrink managed to regularly work Dennis Prager quotes into our sessions. I found this funny and somewhat charming. Mostly it gave me some distance. He was always telling me that I should go to church, get married, and have children so that I'd have a sense of my value as a human being beyond politics and work, those being the two abstractions that motivated my every major decision and which, for me, existed independently of one another only as a distinction without a difference. I also found this funny and somewhat charming. Like most people, he was a little right and a little wrong. I like most people, and I liked him. He once asked in earnest if I had ever considered the possibility that I was unconsciously overextending myself to the point of exhaustion because that's the only kind of rest I felt I deserved. It's an explanation that flattered my sense of duty, but the reality is just that I have the memory of a goldfish, and I compulsively repeat the same cycle of overwork to the point of collapse without even noticing until it's too late. Unless, of course, I write things down. He also once asked if I had considered the possibility that, perhaps, I chase quixotic political ambitions because I know that no matter how hard and smart I work, they will most likely never come to fruition in my lifetime. This may seem counterintuitive, but he has correctly identified a certain type of person who runs rampant on the left. For these Sisyphean radicals, politics offers an identity as a beloved archetype, the righteous underdog, the beautiful loser, the brilliant outsider, etc. They find a perverse sense of security in the job that they will never complete. If it was ever finished, who would they even be anymore? Again, my therapist didn't quite get me right. While it's true that I don't feel I exist if I'm not working, I've always preferred working on almost anything other than politics. Generally speaking, I like writing about politics, and I like podcasting about politics. In the right company, I even enjoy talking about politics. But actually doing politics, campaigns, protests, activism, organizing, what a fucking drag. I've done all those things, and since I'm a lifer, I know I will again, but they will always be a chore for me. It's just not my idea of fun, but I don't do it for fun. Neither do I do it for a sense of identity, belonging, or camaraderie. I had friends before I had politics, and I would keep an eye on anyone in your organization who didn't. And I certainly don't do it for the warm fuzzies. Gross. I do it because I want socialism, and socialism for me is simply a chore that needs to be done. It's like Dorothy's old chestnut. I hate writing. I love having written. Much of my exasperation with doing politics is that socialism is something I wish was already done, so I could get back to reading the short stories of Deborah Eisenberg, convincing my friends to rent a picturesque woodland cabin in bumblefuck California one more time, trying to diagnose my dog's skin allergies, learning to play the Appalachian dulcimer, etc. Socialists become irrelevant to the masses when they forget that the work is intended as a means to an end. The goal isn't to be a socialist, whatever that means. The goal is to change the world so that we can live under socialism, or at least as much socialism as we can manage under the circumstances. Socialism was only ever a means to an end for me. I first threw myself into politics out of frustration with an economy that sabotaged the talents, desires, and ambitions of so many people I knew and loved. What I want, what I have always wanted, is nothing more or less than a relatively democratic worker state that runs smoothly and fairly, one where enough injustice has been resolved that for the average person, politics may be relegated to a minorly inconvenient aspect of civic responsibility, like taking out the trash. I want a socialism that runs mostly on autopilot, so people can spend most of their short time on this earth focusing on what they'd rather be doing if you gave them the time and the money and freedom. I explained this to my therapist, but I'm not sure if he believed me. Nonetheless, we shared an amity. He was always funny, friendly, and sympathetic without being condescending or going easy on me. He has been indispensable in writing this book, along with some occasional chemical help from my prescribing psychiatrist, a left-wing secular Jew who listens to a podcast called Come Town and goes to a CrossFit gym. I sought out both of them because I was starting to panic. I felt deeply compelled to write my own account of the unlikely rise of a post-2008 wave of social democratic politics, and I was becoming overwhelmed by the sense of responsibility I felt to it. My involvement with Occupy Wall Street, Democratic Socialists of America, and the Bernie Sanders campaigns finally felt whole enough to form a complete picture if I could just get it right. Not only did I feel a duty to posterity, but on a personal level, I also desperately needed for people to understand what actually happened, at least as I saw it. So I secured the only therapist in my insurance network who practiced within 30 miles of my apartment and specialized in attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, a diagnosis that I don't really believe in but cannot deny describes me. The following lists are the qualities outlined in Mastering Your Adult ADHD, a cognitive behavioral treatment program client workbook, Treatments That Work, that have been given free rein to dictate the literary style of this book. Symptoms of poor attention: distracted easily, difficulty organizing, easily bored, switch from one task to another, difficulty planning, difficulty concentrating, can't do boring or unattractive tasks. Symptoms of hyperactivity: feel like driven by a motor, restless, can't sit still, always on the go, fidgety. Symptoms of impulsivity: interrupt often, answer questions before a person finishes asking, blurt out inappropriate comments, act before thinking, do things you later regretted, difficulty waiting. Other than the bit about regrets, the list pretty much represents a fair and reasonable description of my temperament, not to mention the conditions under which my writing style has developed over the years. I can see that these qualities may not be as charming to some as they are to others, but they do put me at an advantage to tell the story of an obsessive, impulsive, and hyperactive political moment, one I saw up close and from many angles in all its dauntless turbulence. Good days and bad days both held equal potential for chaos. My ADHD gonzo bricolage may not be your cup of tea, but if you want someone whose neurology perfectly matches the frenetic zeitgeist of a resurgent interest in socialism, I'm made to order. As such, the millennial or younger reader, those who came of age clicking on Wikipedia articles for a specific piece of information, only to find themselves still on Wikipedia 2 hours later, having mired themselves within an endless informational labyrinth of hyperlinks, may find my writing to be a relief. It really is difficult to sit still these days. For the older reader, it may be a bit frustrating at moments, but perhaps it will also provide a crash course into the frenetic attention spans of the first extremely online generation. Even among my peers, I'm a girl of exceptional caprice, but make no mistake, socialism wasn't just a whim or a trend for the millennial Bernie bro, and certainly not for me. I've been a lot of things in my adult life, but the only thing I've always been is a socialist. If you are of a finer vintage, rest assured that this book is for you too. I appreciate your interest and applaud your patience, as I have never had the luxury of indulging in the suburban petty bourgeois' petulant obsession with generational warfare. This is not to say there are no limits to my filial piety. There are plenty of mean old bastards in my political career. Generally, though, I cannot overstate the tenderness and gratitude I feel toward the veterans of the movement, particularly those who kept the torch burning against all odds and in the face of near-universal ridicule, taking the long view, never losing faith despite the state of the world, content in the work they knew was unlikely to bear fruit in their own lifetimes. Odds are I'll be one of them someday, so thank God I never held any particular attachment to youth. It's a fool who doesn't learn from the experiences of their elders, even when they're not always their wisers. This is a book about a millennial socialist's ridiculous adventures in left politics, and what happened when I threw all my weight behind an unlikely insurgent left-wing presidential campaign. Sounds good to a publisher, but it's hardly reinventing the wheel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.